So I'll start my today's session with the last question that we did in the previous circle session, because there was a confusion with respect to the transverse common tangents. Okay. And I'll take that question once again for you, just for the transverse common tangents. And post that, I will talk about angle of intersection of two circles. And I will also touch upon the concept of pole and polar today, because in some of the DPPs, the concept of pole and polars are there. However, pole and polar is not a very, very important concept. I mean, in case JEE Advanced decides to ask it, it will ask it as a comprehension type question. Okay. So we'll be prepared with everything. Don't worry. So let's take the last question of previous session. The question was find all common tangents, but we'll find only the transverse common tangents. Find transverse common tangents for the equation x square plus y square plus 6x minus 2y plus 1 equal to 0, and for the equation x square plus y square minus 2x minus 6y plus 9 equal to 0. Okay, we had figured out the center of this circle. The center of this circle was at minus 3 comma 1, and this was the center. Let me call it as C1. And the radius of this circle, the radius of this circle was 3 units. Okay, so I'll just quickly write down that information because I don't want to spend time there. And the radius of this guy was 1 unit. Okay, and we were looking for the transverse common tangents for these two circles. So let me make the two circles first of all. Okay, let me make them spaced apart again. So let's say this is your C1, minus 3, comma 1. This is your C2, 1, comma 3. The radius of this was 3 units. Radius of this was 1 unit. So you can see the larger one has a 3 unit. Now I want to know the equation of the transverse common tangent. Now we all know that the transverse common tangents and the line connecting the centers of the circle meet at ICS. Right? What is ICS? Internal center of similitude. So if you connect this, it will meet at this point T, and basically T divides the join of C1, C2 internally in the ratio of 3:1. Okay. So first let us figure out what is the coordinate of T. So for coordinates of T, you can use your section formula, internal division section formula. So 3 into 1, okay, 1 into minus 3 by 3 plus 1, comma, 3 into 3 plus 1 into 1 by 3 plus 1. So this clearly gives you 0, comma, this will be 9 plus 1, 10, 10 divided by 4. 10 divided by 4 is 5 by 2, correct? No, I'm not talking about the last class one. Last class was DCT. I'm talking about TCT today, transverse common tangent. There are two groups of tangents, Shraddha. One is direct common tangents. Direct common tangents meet at external center of similitude. That is the point where the join of C1, C2 is externally divided in the ratio of R1 and R2. R1:R2. This is transverse common tangent. Okay. So see the question. Question is already saying find the transverse common tangents. TCT. Okay. All right. So moving on with this. So having got this point, now we are going to assume that there is a line with a slope of M passing through T. Okay. So let the equation of one of the TCTs be y minus 5 by 2 is m x minus 0. Okay, so what I'm assuming that the equation of the tangent or equation of a transverse common tangent is given by this. Okay, if you just simplify this, it gives you 2 m x plus 5. Okay, now let me write it in the general form. Now this line is a tangent to any one of the two circles. You can take any one of the two circles. Let me take the smaller one, C2. It's a tangent to C2. If this line is a tangent to C2, that means the distance. Oh, my bad. Yeah. Yeah, that means the distance of this line from the center of C2 should be equal to 1. That is the radius. So this distance should be equal to 1. Okay, so we'll use that. So we'll put 1,3 in this point and find out the distance. So it will be 2 into 3 minus 2m into 1 minus 5 mod by under root of 2 square plus 2m square. And this should be equal to 1. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns here? Okay, so 1 and 3, I put it over here, 1 and 3. And then I found out that. Now this gives you mod of 2m minus 1. So this is mod of 2m minus 1. And this is equal to under root of 4 plus 4m square. Let's square both the sides. If you square both the sides, you'll end up getting 2m minus 1, the whole square is equal to 4m square plus 4. On simplification, if you realize, one very interesting thing is happening over here. The interesting thing is the m square term goes off, right? So we were supposed to get a quadratic out of it because we should be having two m values for the two slopes of the TCTs, right? But here you realize that your m square term is getting cancelled. In other words, your m is just coming out to be minus 3/4. Okay. So what does it actually mean? If you are getting only one m value from that particular equation, or for that matter, the quadratic equation has the coefficient of m square as 0. So if you properly write it, you are writing something like this: 0 m square minus 4 m minus 3 equal to 0, right? So in a quadratic, when the coefficient of m square becomes, or the coefficient of x square, talking about, let's say, a normal quadratic equation, becomes 0, what does it indicate? It indicates that the quadratic has actually become a linear. When quadratic becomes linear, means one of the roots has actually gone to plus or minus infinity. See, this is what happens. Let me just show you on the GeoGebra. So I'm just going to write a simple quadratic. Yeah, one second. Yeah. So first of all, I'm just going to take a value. Yeah, take a value of a and keep it to let's say minus 5 to let's say 5. Okay. Now I'll write a quadratic using this. So y is equal to ax square plus, let's say, minus, let's say 3x plus 2. Okay. Or let's say minus 10, minus not 10, minus 6. Okay. Now, if you see, this is the quadratic. Now I'm going to play with my a value. I'm going to drag this towards 0. See what will happen. When you are going towards 0, the moment you make a 0, you realize that this graph will convert to a linear. If you see this graph, this has become a linear graph of minus 3x minus 1 equal to 0. What does it indicate? One of the roots is here, other root has gone to infinity or minus infinity. You may, term it as anything. Okay, doesn't make a difference. But what it indicates that is one of the roots is minus 3/4 and the other root, let's say I call it as m1, then the other root will actually be tending to infinity. Now, this is a valid answer for us because in lines, we can have slopes tending to infinity, right? So how would I write the equation here? Now see the equation. This is how we write it. So first of all, y minus 5/2 is equal to m. This m is minus 3/4. So write it down, minus 3/4x. So simplify this, multiply throughout with 4. Probably this will give you something like this. Or 3x plus 4y minus 10 equal to 0. So this is one of the answers. Okay. And for the other answer, If your m tends to infinity, it is as good as saying x minus 0 is 0. That means x equal to 0. That means your y-axis will become another answer to this question. Okay. So don't be surprised that, oh, I'm getting one of my answers as infinity and there's supposed to be two answers. It's fine. Infinity is one of the, you can say, accepted roots of this equation, especially when you're talking about the slope. Okay. Slope can tend to infinity. Okay, now some questions. Servo circles have one point of intersection. Both circles have one point of intersection. No, they are not intersecting at all. Sir, can you show the diagram again? Yeah, see the diagram. So the circles are so oriented that one of the transverse common tangents is vertical. Now, this is something which is very subjective, Aditya. We cannot comment on that. But especially when you're dealing with, this is something I told in the straight line chapter also, if you remember. In straight line chapter, the slope can be infinity. So if infinity comes out as an answer from solving an equation which is dealing with the slope, then don't ignore it. That could be one of the answers. Could you explain the M part again? Did you join late by any chance? Which part? This part or the solution part? Kinshuk. Which part are you talking about? Infinity thing. See what happens normally. In our normal circumstances, this should give me a quadratic in M. Correct? But here what you're seeing is that there is no quadratic getting formed in N because the highest degree terms of M are getting cancelled. Now, it doesn't mean that you will not have two values. You will still have two values technically because there has to be two transverse common tangents between them. Right? So, how does this equation actually support that cause? So, the absence of one of the root basically indicates that the other root is infinity because the coefficient of M square actually becomes a zero. So see, when the coefficient of x square becomes zero, what can you comment about the sum of the roots or product of the roots? That will also tend to infinity. It is because one of the quantity is finite and the other quantity is infinite. So their product becomes infinite on and their sum also becomes infinite. So this is how this particular fact justifies that there could be infinity as one of the or minus infinity as one of the slopes coming out from this equation. Is this fine? I think Anusha was the one who asked this question to me as a doubt. She was trying to solve it and she realized that one of her roots was not coming up. So in such cases, please see, that is why I always say drawing a diagram accurately always helps. So you will, when you draw this diagram accurately, you would realize that there was actually an infinite tangent. Let me show you how. So let me just go to GeoGebra again. Let me make both the circles for you. So that will make more sense to you. So let me type down the equation. So first equation was x square plus y square minus 2x minus 6y minus 6y plus 9 equal to 0. Plus 9 equal to 0. And the other equation was x square plus y square plus 6x plus 6x minus 2y minus 2y plus 1 equal to 0. Okay, you can clearly see that they have a transverse common tangent, which is the y axis itself. So x equal to 0 is clearly one of the transverse common tangents, right? And the other one is what we figured out. What was the answer that we got? 3x. Let me just drag it here. 3x plus 4y minus 10 equal to 0. 3x plus 4y minus 10 equal to 0. There you go. This is the other transverse common tangent. Let me just zoom in a bit. Is it visible to everybody? Okay. So with this, we conclude the direct and transverse common tangents concept. And I'm going to now talk about a concept linked to intersection of two circles, and that is the angle of intersection of two circles. So let me talk about that as well, because this is one of the important concepts. Angle of intersection of two circles. So obviously, the two circles given to you in this question must be intersecting. Okay, so let us say I take the general form. I take the general form of the two circles like this. So let's say this is your circle C1. This is your circle C2. Okay, by the way, I should refrain from using this. I should use your S and S dash as the name of the circles. So this is your another circle. So basically, I'm trying to say S equal to 0 and S dash equal to 0. These are the two circles given to you. Okay, and they intersect. Let me make the two circles. So one is this and other is this. Are you? Why are you moving? Yeah. Okay. So how do you define the angle of intersection, first of all, between two circles? So angle of intersection is defined as the angle between the tangents. So let me first make tangents at the point of intersection. So I have made one tangent like this. Okay, so this is a tangent to the yellow circle at this point. Let me call this point as point A. And this is a tangent. Let me make it in different color, maybe in red. This is a tangent made to the blue circle at the very same point. There you go. Okay. So how is the angle of intersection between two circles defined? Angle of intersection is defined. Let me write it down. Angle of intersection definition. This is going to be useful in your application of derivatives concept also when we are doing tangents and normals. Angle of intersection between two curves is defined as the acute angle made between the tangents to the two curve, in this case the circles, at their point of intersection. See, there are two points of intersection here. One is point A and other is point B. But if you can see from the symmetry of the figure, this angle between the two tangents, or the acute angle between the two tangents, let me call this as the acute angle, that is not going to change. So whether you make this analysis at A or make this analysis at B, theta is not going to change because of the symmetry of the two curves. Okay. So please note this definition down. It is the acute angle made between the tangents to the two curves at their point of intersection. So it is the acute angle between the tangents made to the two curves at their point of intersection. Now, how do I find this angle theta? Let's say I know everything about, this circle. So I know its center. Okay. So let's say center C1 and center C2, I already know. So basically I know the distance between their centers. And I know their respective radii also. So let's say this is your R1, this is your R2. Okay. First, let us try to find out in terms of, let's say C1, C2 is your distance D. Let's say in terms of D, R1 and R2, let us try to figure out what is this angle theta. Let us use our triangle, you know, the properties of triangle which we had studied last year under trigonometry to figure out this angle. Now, any suggestion coming from any one of you? Cosine law. Okay. Kaise use karoge cosine law? How will you use cosine law? Drop a perpendicular from where? When you say drop a perpendicular, you should mention from where and to where. From A to B. Okay. If I drop a perpendicular from A to B, okay, then how do you find it out? Sir, we know theta is angle C1, C2A. C1, C2A or C1, AC2? C1, AC2. Now, okay. Now, this is something very interesting. Everybody, please pay attention. Aditya is claiming that theta is this angle. Is he right or wrong? Chitij is saying absolutely wrong. Aditya, that angle is not theta. It gives you a feeling that it is not theta. Now, everybody pay attention. Okay. Everybody please pay attention. Now, let us say the angle which he has called as theta, I will not call it as theta because it's not theta. Let me call it as an alpha. Theek hai? Alpha to bula sakte na. Okay. Now, let me call this angle as 90 degree. What call, sir? It is 90 degree. Let me call this angle as 90 degree. Sir, it is 90 degree. Okay. Now, everybody please pay attention. Right, Pranav. Right. Pranav is absolutely correct. Pranav is on fire. Yes. So, all of you please pay attention. If you see theta plus 90 plus alpha plus 90, right? We all know it's going to make up a 360 degree because full circle is going to get formed. Okay. So, from here, can I say, correct me if I'm wrong, theta is going to be 180 minus alpha, or for that matter, alpha is going to be 180 degree minus theta. Is this relation clear to everybody? Right? Now, using alpha, I can use my cosine law. That cosine law part, everybody got it right. Okay. But when you're finding cosine law, you're finding it on alpha. Okay. So cosine law says cosine of alpha is d square minus r1 square minus r2 square by, oh, sorry, one second. Other way around, I actually took a negative of it. Yeah. So it's r1 square plus r2 square minus d square by 2r1 r2. This is what the cosine law says. So please note cosine law for anybody who has forgotten what is the cosine law. Cosine law says, let's say I call this as an angle A, call this B. Cosine of angle A is nothing but B square plus C square minus A square by 2BC. Okay, so please recall this. So here I can say cos of alpha is this. Now cos alpha is cos 180 degree minus theta. Right? And actually this is what was going on in my mind. So this is nothing but negative cos theta. Okay. And just send the negative sign to the other side. If you send the negative sign to the other side, you end up getting the result as d square minus r1 square minus r2 square by 2r1 r2. So please, please, please make a note of this. This is a very important formula that is going to be useful. This is the angle between, this is the angle between, acha, one important thing is, please note that you have to mention the acute angle. So you have to take a modulus of this. Okay. So please note, this is the angle between the two circles and we always state the acute angle. That is why we are taking modulus of it. So angle between two curves is always defined as the acute angle between them. Fine. Now, a couple of things that I would like to, yes, sure. Now, a couple of things I would like to analyze from that formula. So I'm waiting for Shitish to copy anything if you want. Shitish, done with it? Let me know. Done. Okay. Okay. So now, a couple of things that we can figure out from this formula. Number one, if theta happens to be 90 degree, you would realize that cos of theta would actually become a zero. And that means d square minus r1 square minus r2 square will actually become a zero. That means r1 square plus r2 square will actually become a d square. What does this mean? It means r1, r2 and d will form a right angle triangle, thereby following a Pythagorean triplet over there. So see what is going to happen exactly in the figure. Let me show you. So let's say this was your one of the circles and this was your another circle. When this angle is 90 degree, you would realize that, please pay attention, you would realize that this tangent, the tangent drawn to the white circle and the tangent drawn to the red circle, they will eventually pass through each other's center. So this will pass through the center of the red one and this will pass through the center of the white one. So when 90 degrees getting formed, you realize that R1, R2 and D will form a Pythagorean triplet. That means a right angle triangle will get formed. Otherwise, it will not. Only when under a special situation, when the circles are making or when the theta angle is 90 degree, then R1, R2 and D will form a right angle triangle, suggesting the fact that this white tangent will pass through C1 and this yellow tangent will pass through C2. Why can't R1 and R2 be the tangents of the opposite circle? This is a special condition under which it will happen, Siddhant. Not the other way around. So if you see this case, then this gray line did not pass through C1 or should not pass through C1. And this red tangent should not pass through C2. Only when the angle of intersection becomes such that theta is 90 degree, then this gray line will start passing through C1 and this red line will start passing through C2. Please make a note of this. Why? Because many people, always when they are drawing the intersection, they will make the tangent pass through the center of the other. No, that is a very special occasion when it happens. When the sun and the moon and the stars are at a special, in a certain position, this will happen. Okay, so Siddhant said in this case, A will be equal to theta, right? In this case, alpha will be equal to theta, right? Because as you can see in this relation, alpha is 180 degree minus theta. So theta, if you put 90, alpha will also become 90. So that is the situation when what Aditya said would have made sense. Then alpha and theta would have been the same. Right, Siddhant. Good. I like the way you people are all analyzing things. That's very, very important, especially. Okay, now this is a condition where we say the circles are orthogonal to each other. Right, so this is... So this is the condition when theta is 90, we say the circles cut each other, orthogonally. Okay. And this condition that you see over here, that is called the condition of orthogonality. Okay. But I will write this in a more robust manner in terms of G1, G2, C1 and C2 because you will say, sir has given this equation, sir is not using only. I will use it. Now the time has come that I will use this. So I will figure out what is the relationship between G1, G2, F1, F2, C1, C2 under this particular scenario, which is the condition of orthogonality. Okay. So give me one more minute. I will just derive the condition. And that condition also has to be kept in mind. Very, very useful condition. Used several times in problem solving. So what is this condition? What is this condition? Okay, let me write it on top. Okay, now let me just talk about condition of orthogonality here. Condition of orthogonality. So condition of orthogonality was R1 square plus R2 square is equal to D square. That means R1, R2 and the distance between the center must form Pythagorean triplets. Now what is R1 square as per the equation? I don't have to even look at it. I can say directly it is G1 square plus F1 square minus C1. Under root square, so nothing will be written. And R2 square was what? G2 square plus F2 square minus C2. I hope everybody is fine with this. And what is the distance between them? Let us try to write that down. Distance between them is the distance between minus G1 minus F1 and minus G2 minus F2. So can I say the distance between them would be given by this? Please correct me if I'm wrong. Convinced? Everybody? Happy? Okay, so let me expand the right side of it. G1 square plus G2 square minus 2G1 G2 and this is F1 square plus F2 square minus 2F1 F2. And on this side we have G1 square, G2 square, F1 square, F2 square minus C1 minus C2. Okay, so So that sounds should come of cancellation. Okay. Now, if you write it in a proper way, you'll write, you'll get 2g1 g2 plus 2f1 f2 is equal to c1 plus c2. This is something which you should note down, put a star around it. Why I'm crossing it? One second. Yeah, box. Yes, this is a very, very important condition, which is called condition of orthogonality. This is called condition of orthogonality. 2g1 g2 plus 2f1 f2 is equal to c1 plus c2. This is a condition to be followed when two circles are intersecting in such a way that the tangents drawn to those respective circles at the point of intersection are at right angles to each other. Any questions here? Any questions here? Now, this is the one which is important. The next one is, if your theta is zero, that just means the circles are touching each other. If your theta is zero, it means the circles are touching each other. Okay, that means the tangents that you have drawn, they will become coincident. Okay. They will become coincident. That means the circles are touching each other. Can it be expressed in terms of S stat, S1 you're trying to say? I don't know. I've never tried that out, but I never found any such expression also. If at all, Kinshuk, you're able to, you know, get to that. But The question to be asked is, the moot question is, will it be helpful in some cases? Why do we normally fall on S, S1, T, etc.? Because they make our expression quite easy for us to remember. So this expression is already easy. There is nothing like, you know, difficult about it. Both the expressions, in fact, this expression, this is the core principle and this is the outcome of that core principle. Both the expressions are quite easy. I have not tried to figure out how they would be related in terms of their respective power of points. If at all you are able to figure something out, do disclose. Okay, a lot of discoveries should be, kept on. You know, you should be doing those discoveries. Okay, anyways, so this is something which is important, and with respect to this, we will take few questions now. Okay, so just quick recap, whatever we have done in this particular page, we basically talked about angle of intersection of two circles. Angle of intersection of two circles is defined as the acute angle between the tangents to the two circles at their point of intersection. And for that, we use cosine law. From cosine law, we came to this expression, which on simplification gave you this. To make it acute, I took a theta just to be on a safer side. When theta is 90 degrees, the two circles are said to be orthogonal to each other. And the condition for orthogonality is R1 square plus R2 square is equal to D square. Or in terms of, if in terms of the expression of the equation, you can say 2G1 G2 plus 2F1 F2 is equal to C1 plus C2. Let's take questions on this. Okay. So let's say these are the two circles. Find the angle between the two circles. See, what happens between the, when the circles are not intersecting? If the circles are not intersecting, you will always realize that there is no point of intersection. So the concept of angle of intersection will not hold true, right? But still, if you are finding the angle using that means you are basically trying to find out. See, what does that angle actually help you? The angle is basically applied. Let's say the circle were like this. Okay. This is your R1, this is your R2. Okay, and this is your D. Okay. In that case, I have a feeling that, I mean, I have not tried it out, but it may lead to invalid expression for cos theta. Maybe more than one as an answer may come. I have a feeling like that. Okay. It should be actually, because if you take D to be very, very large as compared to R1 and R2, so you can see that the effect of the R1 square and R2 square will be very less in compare. Oh, you tried it. Cos theta is, oh, so Pranav has confirmed my answer. He's saying that he tried it and he realized that cos theta is coming out to be more than 1. Okay, thank you, Pranav. Yes, simple question. Everybody should do it quickly, quickly, quickly. You already know the formula. You just have to figure out R1, R2, D and put it in the formula. Please give me a response on the chat box. Very good, that's correct. Kinshuk, that's correct answer. See, it doesn't matter whether you're using this formula or this formula. It doesn't make a difference because you are keeping everything under the mod situation. Okay. Ultimately, the mod is going to give you the same thing. Pi by 4 is absolutely correct. Guys, let us discuss it. That is not a big deal. So first of all, for the S circle, for S equal to 0 circle, the center of the circle was at 2, -3. The radius of this circle is under root of 2² + 9 - 11. How much does it give you? This gives you root 2. For S dash equal to 0, the center is going to be, the center of the circle is going to be 1, -4. So R2 is going to be under root of 1 + 16 - 13. So this is going to be 2. Correct? So now the distance between this, the centers is given by under root of 2 - 1², which is 1. And again, this, which is 1, which is root 2. Okay. So definitely the sum of the radii exceed the distance between the centers. So there has to be an intersection happening. And if the intersection is happening, definitely we can find out the angle of intersection by using any one of the two formula. So let us use the second one, R1² + R2² - D² / 2 √2. So this will give us cos theta value as 4/4√2, which is 1/√2. So let's take out of the modular symbol. So theta is going to be π/4 or 45 degrees, whatever you want to state. So that is absolutely correct. Easy question. Arjun, how are you getting 90, dear? Check money. You got your mistake, Arjun. Okay, let's move on to the next one. This was just a warm-up question for us. Next is, show that the two circles, this and this, cut orthogonally. Show that these two circles cut orthogonally. That also is easy. You just have to verify the formula which I discussed a little while ago with you. Done. Just say done if you're done. Okay, very simple. So what is G1 here? G1 is -3. What is F1 here? F1 is 2. What is C1 here? C1 is 4. What is G2 in the second equation? G2 in the second equation is half. F2 in the second equation is 2. And C2 in the second equation is 1. Just figure it out. What is 2g1 g2 plus 2f1 f2? So 2g1 g2 is going to be minus 3. 2f1 f2 is going to be 8. So the sum is coming out to be 5. And what is c1 plus c2? c1 c2 is clearly 4 plus 1, which is 5. What does this imply? This implies 2g1 g2 plus 2f1 f2 is equal to c1 plus c2, implying that the circles are orthogonal to each other. Is this fine? Easy question. Not a problem. So while solving this question, should we stepwise against this? You mean to say, do we have to derive the result as this is what you mean? Stepwise means what? Stepwise means I didn't get you. You just have to find 2g1 g2 plus 2f1 f2 and try to show whether it's coming out to be equal to c1 plus c2. Derivation need not be done because this is anyways, see now you have passed out 11th. This concept is anyways not going to come in any form in your board exam. If you're talking about JEE or any competitive exams, Acha, by the way, very glad to share the VIT triple E results came yesterday. And NPS Rajaji Nagar student Tripan has scored All India rank 266. Okay, it's a good rank actually because VIT triple E is considered to be an exam with no negative marks. So many people score good there. I mean, even people who are not that worthy, they come up in the ranking because they do some kind of a guesswork and you know, all those things. So 266 rank Tripan has got, which is the highest that we have got. So I think Pratham got 906, I believe, 906 rank. So Rajaji Nagar is always, as usual, rocking in terms of rankings. Okay. Sir, can we also do this by finding the theta? Yeah. You find R1, you find R2, you find D square, and you show that R1 square plus R2 square is equal to D square. That means they form a Pythagorean triplet. From there only this condition has come, no, Arjun. This condition has not come from the sky. Okay. Let's take another one. Find the equation of a circle which cuts this circle orthogonally, has its center on the line x equal to 2 and passes through 4, minus 1. Read the question carefully. This coming year, most of you will be registering yourself for different exams. I would say my suggestion would be register yourself at least for 7 exams, if not less. Of course, JEE Main you will be definitely doing, CET you will definitely doing, or Comet K, CET / Comet K depending upon your domicile criteria. BITSAT, Manipal, VIT, these should be definitely be there in your list. Of course, JEE Advanced is subject to your qualification in JEE Main, which I don't doubt at all. And maybe you can try for SRM or these local universities, which probably you will never join. But just register yourself so that you get exposed to that environment of taking these exams. I personally wrote more than 20. And I actually told you the story. I had to travel all over the India to write these exams. In the beginning itself, my dad made all the railway reservations. Whole year I was just traveling. In my time, there used to be AI triple E. There used to be JEE. JEE used to be JEE prelims and then main JEE. Main JEE is the advanced JEE that you have. Then I wrote West Bengal JEE, I wrote Jharkhand JEE, I wrote Bihar JEE, I wrote BITS, Birla, BIT Mishra exam. That time BIT Mishra used to have a separate exam. Then I wrote CET also. That time CET was open category. So many exams I wrote. Very good. Awesome. Very good, Pranav. Aditya, check your working. I think the figures are not correct. Let's check your working. Correct, Kinshuk. Kinshuk, just check the sign of your Y coefficient. Is it the same or the negative of that? Now Kinshuk will write OOF and then he will correct it. So Gayatri, you are getting some ugly figures for coefficient of Y. Okay, let's discuss this, guys. I think most of you would have definitely attempted it. Okay, Aryan. See, let the circle that I'm looking for, let the circle which I'm looking for has this equation x square plus y square plus 2gx plus 2fy plus c equal to 0. Okay. This circle is basically passing through 4 comma minus 1. Okay. And its center lies on x equal to 2 line. Now, center lying on x equal to 2 line, what does it indicate? It indicates its center has to be 2 comma something, right? Because x equal to 2, center has to have abscissa as 2, right? Let's say the y coordinate is, normally we know the y coordinate is minus f, right? As per this general form of the equation, coordinates of the center is minus g minus f. So you know for sure that g minus g is 2, so g is equal to minus 2, okay? So this everybody would have got it, not an issue. Second thing is, you know that this point 4 comma minus 1 satisfies this. So if you put 4 comma minus 1 on this, you'll get 16 plus 1 plus 8x minus 2y plus c equal to 0. Correct? So this gives you 17, oh sorry, 8g and... Yeah, sorry, 8g and minus 2f. So you know your g is minus 2. So g is minus 2 means this is minus 16. So minus 2f plus c equal to 0. So one equation you end up getting is 1 minus 2f plus c is equal to 0. So let's say I call this equation number 2. Let's say this is your 1. Okay, so these two equations are very important for us. Okay. I hope I have not made any silly mistake anywhere. Do let me know in case anything has gone wrong anywhere in the calculation part only. Now, this circle is cut by another circle. Let me make that in white. Orthogonally. Okay. It is cutting each other orthogonally. So, we know that condition between the G1, G2, F1, F2 and C1, C2. So, this circle has G as 5 by 2. So, 2G into G1, G1 will be 5 by 2, plus 2F and the F here will be 7 by 2. So 2G1, G2, 2F1, F2 is equal to C1 plus C2. That is minus 4 plus C. Okay. So from here we'll get another equation, that is 5G plus 7F minus C is equal to minus 4. So this is our third equation. Okay. Now we already know the G value, right? We already know the G value. G value is minus 2. So this will become a minus 10. So this will become a 6. Now add these two. If you add these two, you'll end up getting 1 plus 5F is equal to 6. So 5F is equal to 5. So F comes out to be 1. Correct. If F comes out to be 1, that means 7 minus C is equal to 6. So C comes out to be 1 again. Now we know everything about the given unknowns. So our circle equation required will be x square plus y square plus 2gx plus 2gx is minus 4x plus 2fy. 2fy will be 2y plus 1 equal to 0. So this is your desired answer. This is your desired answer, and let me check how many of you actually got it. Ruchita, you are getting a point circle. Is it a point circle? I don't think so. Aryan, ugly figures. Gayatri, ugly figures. I think Kinshuk now got it correct. Oh, no. Kinshuk also made a sign mistake here. Pranav Dharmagadi got it correct. Well done. Yeah, I mean, concept-wise, there's no problem at all. I can understand that. But where you would have probably got wrong is simplification or playing with these three equations or solving these three equations simultaneously. Okay. So with this, we conclude the concept of angle of intersection of two circles. And now I'm going to move towards the concept of pole and polar. Very interesting concept. However, it is, it will not be asked directly in any competitive exam, but you should be knowing the concept per se. So what is the concept of pole and polar? So pole is basically a point and polar is basically a line. Okay. Now these two, this point and this line are actually linked to each other. How? Let me show the linkage actually. So let's say this is a circle. Okay. Any circle. Okay. If you take a point, let's say anywhere, let's say I take a point here. Let's say this is my point X1, Y1. Okay. Now, through this particular point, let me draw all possible secants to this circle. But for the sake of simplicity, I'll just draw two of them. One, ayyo, whenever I want to draw a line, circle ban jata. Let's say I make one of this is like this, and I make, by the way, this is passing through it, so you can just extend it to the other side. And the other one, I will make it like this. Okay, just for the purpose of making the diagram, you know, slightly good to look at. So what I'm doing, there is a circle, there is a point X1, Y1. Through that point X1, Y1, I'm drawing several secants. So there can be infinitely so many secants that you can draw to this circle, isn't it? Now what do you do? The points where these secant cut the circle, start drawing tangents to the circle at that point. Okay. So here also I start drawing tangents to the circle at that point. Okay, so I've just shown you two secants, but had you drawn, let's say, millions and trillions of secants, you'll realize that their meeting point will actually lie on a line. Let me draw that line. Their meeting point will basically lie on a line. It looks like as if it is coinciding. Let me just make it slightly this side. Manual drawing I can change easily. Okay, so let's say it is a situation like this. These two are meeting here. Yeah, let me just read all the tangents. So these two are meeting here. Just for the purpose of drawing it. And these two are meeting. Okay. So this line is basically called the polar for this pole. So this is a pole and this is the polar. Right? So definition wise, what is a polar? Polar is nothing but it is the point of intersection of the tangents drawn at the meeting point of the secant drawn from the pole to the circle. Okay, so let me illustrate this process to you on GeoGebra. Okay, so on GeoGebra, I'll make this process. Let me just cancel this off and open this once again. Yeah. See, all of you, just let's take a standard case of a circle. X square plus y square is equal to 9. That's it. Okay. Now what I do, I choose a point over here. Let's say I choose this point. Fine. Now through this point, I'm going to draw several secants to this particular circle. So let's say I make one like this. Okay. Okay, I make another one like this. Okay, I make another one like this. Okay, just making three of them. Doesn't matter whether I make 3 or 30 or 300. That line is going to be the same. Now, what I'm going to do, at the point of intersection, let's say this point, let's say this point, let's say this point. By the way, the one which is in between will go to a large extent, so you'll not see the point of intersection there. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to now draw tangents to the circle at those points of intersection. Tangents here to this circle. Tangent here to this circle. Tangent here to this circle. Tangent here to this circle. Okay. Tangent here to this circle. As I told you, it will go very far away. You will not be able to see where it is intersecting. But let me just zoom in a bit. Yeah. Now, it has all become khichdi. But what I'm trying to say is just focus on these points. Focus on this point. So here, basically, you had drawn a tangent at this point and a tangent at this point, which was meeting at this location. Am I right? Meeting at tangent at this point, tangent at this point. You're meeting at this location. Okay. I hope I have drawn correct. Oh, sorry. This is not this location. Yeah, it is this location, I believe. Yes or no? Yeah. This location, and this location. Okay. So I'm just naming it. Focus on A, B, and C. Okay. If you connect them, you will realize that they are all falling on the same line. And this red line that you are seeing on your screen right now, this red line is called the polar for this blue point A, which is your pole. Understood? Does it make sense? Does it make sense? Any question, any concern with respect to that? Okay, now we will prove it. We'll prove it, Shitesh, don't worry. So now many people ask me, sir, could this point have been on the circle? Could this point have been within the circle? Now, let me tell you, if the point was on the circle, if the point was on the circle, then for that pole, the polar would have been the tangent drawn to that point. We'll see that. If the point would have been inside the circle, again, we'll get a similar kind of a story. We'll see that in another diagram that I will be drawing just now. So let me first draw it on the tool here, on the iPivot tool over here. So now I'm going to take another case where the circle is like this. Okay, let's say I take the circle. Okay, now this time I'm taking this X1, Y1 inside the circle. Let's say I take it over here, X1, Y1. Okay, and the same story I will repeat. I will draw tangents, I will draw chords passing through this particular point. So let me just draw two of them. I will not draw a lot of them. Let's say this. Okay, and let's say something like this. Okay, so I can draw millions of chords passing through X1, Y1. Now at the point of intersection, at the point of intersection, if you start again drawing tangents, let's say like this. Okay. Again, I'm just drawing a simple situation over here, not a very ugly one. And you start joining their point of intersection, you would realize this will lie on a line. This will lie on a line. All the points. So I've just shown you two, but if you draw any other chord also and make tangents at the extremities of that chord, they will also meet on the very same line. So this will become the polar for this pole. Is it clear? If the point is on the circle, if the point is on the circle, in that case, the polar will become the tangent drawn to that point on the circle. Let us try to figure that situation also, but now we'll go into the equation part of it. So if I know the circle equation, and if I know the location of the pole, can we find out the equation of the polar? this is something which I would like you to first try it out. Yes. if the pole happens to be the center of the circle, then what will happen? The polar will actually go to infinity. Because from a center, if you draw any chord and tangents drawn at the end of the chord, they will never meet. So we'll say the meeting point of all those set of parallel chords will be at infinity. So in that case, the polar will go to infinity. So that's a very extreme case of it, Aditya. Okay. Pranav, I actually explained that, probably you didn't hear. If the pole is on the circle, then the tangent drawn to that point itself is the polar. Do one thing. First, figure out what is the equation of the polar. उससे आपको सब कुछ पता चल जाएगा. A lot of things will come up. So my question to everybody is plain and simple. Let us say this is my circle x square plus y square is equal to a square. ठीक है? This is my pole x1 y1. Give me the equation of the polar. Polar, whatever you want to call it, just a pronunciation. What is the equation of the polar? How will you find it out? Think. You already know all the concepts. Sab kuch aata hai aap logo ko. Aap log apply nahi karte ho bas. So basically, what are you looking? You are looking for the locus of the meeting point of the tangents drawn at the extremities of the chord which has been made through x1, y1. I hope I'm not using a long statement over here. Again, I'll repeat. What am I doing? I'm finding the locus of, locus means a path traced by h, k, or the path traced by the meeting point of the tangents drawn from the extremities of the chord passing through the pole. Think this to be in a reverse direction. Then you will be able to, yes, chord of contact, exactly. Awesome, Kinshuk. Right, that's the whole point, Aniruddha. The intersection will always be lying on the very same line. That is what we are trying to figure out through the locus. Locus will tell you that it is a line or something else. Yes. See, let's try to figure this out. Have you all done? I mean, anybody who is done with the equation of the polar? If yes, say done. It's just two lines, my dear. Just two lines. Usse zyada kuch bhi nahi hai. Okay. So, all of you, please pay attention. If I ask you to give me the equation of the COC. Okay. What is the equation of the COC? The chord of contact. You will say, the chord of contact drawn from h, k onto the circle equation will be xh plus yk is equal to a square, right? Can I say this COC is satisfied by x1, y1? So x1, y1 will satisfy COC. Correct? That means x1h, y1k is equal to a square. This is done, my dear friend. You are done with the answer. Now generalize it. Generalize it. Make your h as x. Make your h as x. Make your k as y and you are done. So xx1 plus yy1 is equal to a square. This itself is the equation of the polar. This itself is the equation of the polar. Now people say, what? Again? This fellow came again? See, when I was discussing t equal to 0 to you, I already informed you that t equal to 0 will stand for several types of equation. One is the tangent drawn if x1, y1 is on the circle. Second is, it will be the chord of contact if your x1, y1 is outside. So now this is something very important. All of you, please realize this, that this polar that you have actually got, it is actually the cord of contact when you connect this point to the extremity. So this actually is the cord of contact also, and it is actually polar also. So if the point is outside the circle, t equal to 0 will represent the cord of contact undoubtedly, no doubt about that. But that same cord of contact will also be the polar or polar, whatever you want. Are you getting my point? So the same formula is behaving in two ways. In fact, in three ways, I should say. Number one, it is behaving like the equation of a tangent had this point x1, y1 been on the circle. And that is precisely why I said that your polar will be your tangent drawn to the pole if the pole lies on the circle. Got it now? This equation supports it. If this x1, y1 lands on the circle, this polar will actually be tangent. You can also observe that if this starts moving towards the circle, this polar will also start moving towards that point. Okay. Second thing is the same equation behaves as the chord of contact also. So from this point, if you draw a chord of contact, the chord of contact will also be the same. Okay. Tangent, chord of contact, polar. They all have t equal to 0. But here you have to see the t is formulated by using what x1, y1. Is it on the circle, outside the circle, within the circle? If it is within, it is completely a polar. If it is outside, polar and chord of contact are same. If it is on, it is the tangent. Polar and tangent will be the same. What the point? So when the point is within the circle, t equal to 0 is completely polar. When the point is on the circle, t equal to 0 is polar also, it's tangent also. And when point pole is outside the circle, t equal to 0 is polar also, chord of contact also. Likh lo if you want. I will write it down for you. Don't worry. Chalo, Arjun has a question. The tangents on the pole touch the circle at the points of intersection of the polar. Right. Exactly. Tabhi to chord of contact ke barabar hua na, Arjun. So Arjun is saying, sir, if the polar cuts it here, then will I say the tangent drawn from there will basically be not touching the circle at the intersection of the circle and the polar? Yes. Is there a way to show geometrically COC is polar? Yes. There is a tool in GeoGebra which helps us to show that. Thank you to the GeoGebra community, that some enthusiast, coordinate geometry enthusiast, has shown that on the tool. So I'll show that to you. Don't worry. I'll show that. Yes. Dekho. Enjoy the things over here. Very, very interesting things. I am going to show it over here. X square plus y square equal to 9. Okay. Now, let's choose a point. Ek point choose kar lete hain. Let's choose this point over here. Minus 4, comma, minus 3 probably. Okay. Now, There is a button on your GeoGebra which will help you draw the polar for that pole. Kaunsa button hai? Let me show you. Click on this perpendicular. Go down. Third last option. Polar. Okay. Click on that. It will ask you to choose the pole first and the circle or the conic. If you see, this becomes your polar. So this is, I'm sorry. This is your pole. And this is your polar. Okay. Now somebody wanted to know, I think Arjun wanted to know, that if I draw tangents from the pole to the circle, will it hit at these two positions, A, B? Let me show that as well. Actions are louder than the words. So there is a tool in the GeoGebra which helps us to draw a pair of tangents. I think it is this tool. No, this tool. Yeah, tangents. Click on that. Click on the point. Click on the circle. There you go. There you go. Awesome, isn't it? So guys, what did you learn? This is a clear-cut indication that COC and polar, they are just two names of the same equation for this point x1, y1. Clear. Okay. I will tell you more interesting things about it a little later on. Why didn't we do three classes ago? See, I normally see the level of understanding, then I choose my topics. if I think the level of understanding is not that great, I delay it a little bit, but I definitely don't miss it. Is this fine? Okay, now let me choose a point inside and also show you the let me just switch this off. Now let me take a point inside. Chalo yahan pe ek point le lete hain at 1, 1. Ayyo, why you people are back? Delete. Now again, if you want to find out the polar for this pole with respect to this circle, now this is the way to pronounce it. Many people pronounce it wrong. Polar of the pole with respect to the circle. There is no fixed polar for a pole, because if the circle changes, the polar will also change. Similarly, we say pole of the polar with respect to that circle. That with respect to the circle, you should not miss out. Okay. So how would you say? Let me just first draw the polar for this. Choose the point, choose the curve. This is the polar. Okay. So when I say this line is the polar for B, I would say with respect to this circle. Similarly, this point is the pole for this polar with respect to the circle. Are you getting my point? Is it clear? So now let me just go to the screen and write few things which definitely must be noted down and kept in your mind. Important observations are noted down. The following point. Number one. We read this as x1, y1. Is the pole of this polar with respect to the circle. Okay, so it's very important that you read this as this. Okay, so this is your pole, this is the pole, this is the polar, but with respect to this circle, with respect to this circle. Okay. Second important thing that I already told you, but I'm just writing it down for you. If x1, y1 is outside the circle, okay, is outside the circle, okay, then xx1 plus yy1 equal to a square will represent two things. One is the polar of this pole with respect to the circle, and other is the chord of contact. Same equation behaving as two things. So they will be the same straight line. Okay. If x1, y1 is on the circle, then the very same equation will behave as the polar also and tangent at that point. Okay, so tangent itself will be the polar. If this point is inside the circle, then this will purely represent a polar. Polar of the pole with respect to the circle. Is it clear, everybody? Is it clear or not? Clear? Okay. Let me tell you a few more things before we jump on a problem. In case we have more time, we'll take a few more questions. So if you use t square is equal to ss1 when x1 is inside the circle, would we get anything similar to... See, one small thing I would like to highlight here. When you're using it, t square is equal to ss1. S1 will be negative in that sense, right? So what will come out from there? Do one thing, Aditya. This is a very an interesting observation that you should be, you know, trying to do some research on. Take the point inside. Okay. You know what will happen on or outside. That is fine. Take the point inside and try to figure what is t square is equal to ss1 boiling down to. Because from here, the analysis may not be very, very sharp because I'm just able to say that t square is equal to s into a negative quantity. That is what I can say. And what type of equation will come out from there? That is something which we need to look into. You take a generic form only. Don't take a special form. Take a generic form. See what... It is some conic. It is some conic coming out. Okay, anyways, you got a you got an oval shaped structure. Okay, we'll figure that out because that is something which even I have not figured it out because it is not useful. It is not. It doesn't. Nobody asks that type of, you know, concept in the questions also. Okay, now let's analyze something very important. Very, very important. So this is point number two. Point number three. Point number three. If x1, y1 and x2, y2 are such points, such that, let me write, are points such that, x1 lies on the polar of this and vice versa. Okay. So basically, let's say I call this point P and I call this point Q. Right. So P lies on the polar of Q and Q lies on the polar of P. So P and Q lie on each other's polar. Okay. Then P and Q are called conjugate points. They are called conjugate points. Is this fine? Now let me show this demonstration to you. See, all of you please have your attention on the screen right now. Now you can see that B is a point 1, 1, okay, and this is the polar of it. On now this polar, I will choose a point. Let me choose a point on the polar here. Okay. Now with respect to A, if I draw a pole for this particular circle, or let's say choosing A as my pole, I make a polar with respect to this circle. You would realize that that polar will actually pass through the B point. So this is a situation where A is lying on the polar of B with respect to this circle. Let me write it down here. A is lying on the polar of B and B is lying on the polar of A. Okay. Then these two points will be called as the conjugate points. They will be called as the, let me use a different thing. They will be called as the conjugate points. Is it clear? Any questions here, anybody? So there are two points, x1, y1, x2, y2, such that both lie on their each other's polar. Then those two points will be called the conjugate points. Clear? Any questions? Sir, could these two, these two polars can intersect somewhere. They may be parallel also. When it will be parallel, I'll tell you. That is a special occasion. Wait, so any point on B's will have polar through B. Any point on B's polar will have polar through A. Yes. Right. So there will be several set of, you can say, there will be several pairs of conjugate points possible. Right. So let's say if I choose another point. Or for that matter, I shift this point. Let me choose that. All of you, please pay attention. Huh? If I shift this point, see, the polar will also get rotated about B only. Ayo. Do you see that? The polar of A is getting rotated about B. So in this case, whatever point you are shifting your A on, those pairs will be conjugates. So every point on the polar of B is its conjugate. Got the point? Is it clear? So wherever I take this point, you can see the polar of that point will always pass through B. Are you getting my point? Is it clear? Could you repeat this point? See, if I take a point A here, I get a polar of A passing through B. So A and B are conjugate pairs or conjugate points. If I took it here, still the polar of A is passing through B only. That means A and B are still conjugate points. But now A point position has changed. Okay. So now whatever point is it lying on, that point and this point will be conjugate points of each other. So every point on the polar of B will be basically a conjugate point of B, or they will be conjugate points. So whether you take this point, this point, this point, this point, this point, they will all be the conjugate of this guy B. That is what I'm trying to move. Okay. Now, I know many of you would be doing a lot of experimentation. Same will be true for B also. Okay, Hariharan wants me to move B. Chalo, B ko move karta hoon. If you move your B, okay, B is actually, let me move B on the, actually B has, let me do the other way around, because I'm moving the polar also by doing that. So that is getting changed. So let me do another figure. Just one second, Hariharan, I'll show you the, let me make the circle again. Okay, let me take a point this time outside the circle. Okay, let's say A. Now I'm making the polar of A with respect to this circle. Okay, now take any point B on this circle. Let's say I take a point B here or somewhere over here. Let's say. Okay, and I now make the polar of B with respect to the circle. It will pass through A, as we had already seen that. Now, Hariharan, as per your requirement, I will move B. You will see that the polar will still pass through A only. Change nahi karega. Clear, Hariharan? When do the two polars be parallel? That's actually a question I wanted to ask you, but ask the time nahi hai. But I'll tell you that theory also. That's a very good observation, Arjun. Now, all of you, please pay attention. The fourth point is, I don't have much time, so let's discuss it. If L1x plus M1y plus N1 equal to 0 and L2x plus M2y plus N2 equal to 0 are lines such that the pole of one lies on the other, then the two lines are called conjugate lines. Now, conjugate lines comes from the very same diagram. Let's go back again to GeoGebra. So as you can see, these two lines are conjugate lines because their poles respectively lie on the other. But remember, if you vary this point, even the conjugate line pairs will vary. Okay. So these two points, I mean, just at a present situation, these two lines are called conjugate lines. And these two points are called conjugate points. That is what we need to, what we have discovered so far. These two points are called conjugate points. Okay, clear? Any problem with respect to conjugate points and conjugate lines? I'll take a snapshot of this and put it. I've seen some questions being asked, not in JEE main though, maybe in JEE advanced or something, Okay, so these two are conjugate points and these two are conjugate lines. Is it fine? Any questions? Lines, by the way, I wrote a line by mistake. Lines. Okay. Next important understanding that you will all have. Number five. I'll take some point, take some time more. So please bear with me if I take 5 more minutes of your time. Next important thing that you realize is that if you have a circle, okay, just hold on your questions for some time. Okay, hold on your questions for some time. If you have a circle and there is a center O, and let's say this is my point P, okay, X1, Y1. Okay, and I draw a polar with respect to this point P with respect to the circle, and let's say the polar lies here. Ayyo. Sorry, I wanted to make a line. Yeah. Okay. Two things you will observe. One is if you connect your center to P and extend it, it's a very obvious observation. You would realize that number one, OQ, or the line connecting the center to the meeting point of the polar, will be perpendicular to the polar. So this will be making 90 degree. And second point you will observe is that OP into OQ will be always the square of the radius of this circle. So let's say this circle is having a radius of R. So OP into OQ will always be R square. Now I'll quickly prove it. It doesn't take much of a time. First of all, if you know this point is X1, Y1, you easily know the equation of this polar. That is XX1 plus YY1 is equal to R square, correct? So what is the slope of the polar? Slope of the polar will be negative X1 by Y1, correct? Right? So this is also the slope of, or let me write it down like this. What is the slope of OQ or OP, whatever you want to call it? What is the slope of OP or OQ? Slope of OP and OQ can be easily be figured out because this is origin and this is X1, Y1. So you can easily say Y1 by X1. Now, if you take the product of these two, that is M of the polar and M of the OQ line, you will end up getting negative X1 by Y1 into Y1 by X1, canceling it out and giving you a minus 1, clearly indicating that OQ is perpendicular to the polar. Is this fine? Any questions? Now, all of you, please pay attention. The second point is very important because direct questions have been framed on this. OP into OQ is basically R square. How? That is also very easy to prove. OP we know is under root of X1 square plus Y1 square. It is just the distance between origin and that given point. Correct? And what is OQ? OQ is nothing but it is the length of the or it is the distance of the origin from this polar. So what is the distance of the origin from the polar? So you'll put 0 plus 0 minus R square mod by under root of X1 square Y1 square. So when you multiply it, you will automatically see that your denominators will get cancelled and you'll end up getting mod of negative R square, which is actually R square, and that proves the second part of the formula. Now, before I end the story for today, a very important observation. If you draw a polar for Q point with respect to the circle, somebody was asking this question to me, when will the conjugate lines become parallel? You would realize that this conjugate line will now become parallel to this. So this is basically, let me write down, this is basically polar of P. And this is polar of Q. So polar of P and polar of Q will now become parallel to each other. Okay. And in such situations, when this is happening, we say Q is the reflection of P on the circle. Right. So for such conditions, we say P is the reflection of Q and vice versa. And vice versa with respect to the circle. And vice versa with respect to the circle. Okay, now let me show that to you. First, make a note of whatever I have written. So two things. One important thing is that if you connect O to P and extend it to the polar of P, the line segment OQ or the line OQ will be always be perpendicular to the polar. That is number one. Second thing is, if you take OP, extend it to meet the polar at Q, OP into OQ will always be the square of the radius of this circle. And P and Q will be called as reflections of each other about the circle. That means if you take that circle as a mirror, then the reflection of P will be Q, reflection of Q will be P, vice versa. Object and image gets interchanged. We all know that. Okay. So that feature is there in GeoGebra. Let me show that to you. It's a very interesting observation. Guys, all these things which I am saying is missing from your JE books. No matter whatever JE book you are following, whatever I have told so far, I mean, with respect to the reflection and all, that is not there in JE books. Okay, so let me just show that, you know, illustration to you. Okay, yes. Let's choose a point inside here. Okay, let me choose a point inside here. 2, 1. Okay. Now with 2, 1, I would draw a polar. This is the polar. Okay. Now what I'm going to do, from the origin, I'm going to extend. One more important thing. In this GeoGebra, there is a feature called reflect object in circle. So third last option, third part, reflect object in the circle, right? Click that. It will ask you for the point and it will ask you to choose the circle. If you do that, you will automatically get A dash as the reflection. Okay. Now I would like to show you that if you had drawn a polar for A dash, it would give you a line which is passing through A and parallel to the given line which you are seeing on your screen. There you go. Okay, so if you see, slope here is -2, slope here is also -2, so they have become parallel. Okay. So somebody was asking, when do the conjugate lines become parallel? The conjugate lines become parallel when the conjugate points are reflections of each other about the circle. Okay. And another thing that you would all observe from the figure, maybe I will use my tools to exhibit that. If I connect the center of this circle, to A, it will cut the polar at A dash. So let me just make that. Lines from this to this. Is it clear? And this product, let me call it, this into this will be R square. So OA dash into OA will be R square. So under this situation, you would realize that the conjugate lines will be parallel to each other. Now this is something which I would like you to prove. Here you have seen the demonstration, but what is the proof that if two lines satisfy this, or if the two points satisfy this relation, the respective polar of both these points are parallel to each other? Okay, so please take this as a proof. So I'll just do one thing. I will take a snapshot of this and I'll put it as a question for you to solve. Sorry, I'm not reading your doubts right now. I'm just giving the question and then I'll explain you your doubts. Okay. So the question here is, if OA is into OA dash is equal to R square, then prove that the polar of A and polar of A dash are parallel. Okay. This I'm giving you as a homework question. It's very easy. You will be able to do it. Now I would take questions from you. Do you mean the spherical mirror? Yes. Okay, so please do this. And that's all for today. All the best for the people who are writing their UTs to